Thank you, thank you. My talk is called Managing Stage Fright, Music to the Rescue. And I really want to thank the Boston Piano Amateurs Association for giving me an opportunity to talk about this subject, because the Boston Piano, I've been involved now with the Boston Piano Amateurs Association for about 17 years, and my history with performance anxiety has been displayed on the stage of the Boston Piano Amateurs Association going back all the way to 2001. And I have a personal story that I think is kind of compelling, and that's what I want to share with you today, because for me, managing stage anxiety became a very important consideration. You see, I have two points of connection to the subject of managing stage anxiety. One is that I'm an amateur pianist, and I think several of you are amateur pianists as well, and you probably know what it's like to be really anxious about performing. And the other is that I'm a psychiatrist. And so part of what I do during the day is treat people for anxiety. And I really felt that I needed to figure out how to treat my own if I was going to be of any help to any of my patients on this subject. So let me tell you, I will show this picture off wherever I have an opportunity. Have you guys seen this one? This is a picture of me on a large banner that was hanging outside the New England Conservatory. And it was taken while I was performing in one of the New England Conservatory piano interpretation and performance seminars, end of semester recitals. And for me, it's an emblem of what's happened here, because that picture would never have been taken if I had never solved this problem of performance anxiety for myself. Oh, I don't want to give you the wrong impression. If you think that I'm not anxious about performing or about being up here and doing this, you'd be wrong. I get a little bit anxious, but I've managed it in a much better way, and I hope to share with you so what I've done. Okay, so today's talk, I'll define stage fright. I'll tell you about my history of stage fright, going back all the way to the beginning. I'll share with you my current and developing understanding about what happened. I call it music to the rescue. I'll demonstrate at the piano some practical approaches that I've taken to piano practice that I find helpful. And then I'll entertain any questions that you might have. Stage fright or performance anxiety, this is from Wikipedia, is the anxiety, fear, or persistent phobia which may be aroused in an individual by the requirement to perform in front of an audience, whether actually or potentially, for example, when performing before a camera. And from a psychiatric standpoint, performance anxiety is one of the things we call one of the anxiety disorders. It's a subset of the anxiety disorders we call social phobia or social anxiety disorder. I've had a few people who've actually come to me to seek treatment around this concern, primarily a kind of cocktail of medications that they've used to manage the situation. But from a psychiatrist's standpoint, performance anxiety is actually a minor disorder compared to some of the more pervasive anxiety disorders that we treat. And it's not minor if you suffer from it. You've heard that joke, you know, minor surgery is surgery on someone else. Any disorder that you have can be difficult. And I can certainly tell you that it was difficult for me. Here is when my performance anxiety started, right from the beginning. I don't know if you can see that picture, but that's me when I was about 11 years old, sitting at the piano. And I knew, even though I was really attracted to the piano, I knew early on that I wasn't going to be a professional at this because I was too anxious about it. I would have dreams that I was being forced to play in front of some queen of some distant land and that I was going to be executed if I made one mistake.
Wow.
Yeah, you know.
That's anxious.
I was anxious. I was anxious. The pinnacle of my early experience in performance was my college recital. I'm sorry, it's so bright in this room, wonderful lighting, but not if you're trying to show a slideshow presentation, so I'll just tell you what this shows. It shows the program of my piano recital in college. It shows a picture of me up in the right-hand corner performing, and then down in the lower right-hand corner is a picture of me with this incredible beaming smile, and anybody who's been in this position knows what that smile is about, because this is, the thing is over, and I've gotten it out of my way, and I'm just so happy. And the 3 hours before that recital, and I don't even know why I signed up for doing it. You know, we all have this sort of, oh, I can do this, and then, no, you can't. It's really very dangerous. But I signed up for it. I was 3 hours of lying on my bed, crunched up in a fetal position prior to performing in this recital. It went well, and that's often the situation. This is the program from the 2001 Boston Piano Amateurs Competition, the first Boston Piano Amateurs Competition. I'm sorry that you can't see these slides well, but on the left is the cover, on the right is the page that includes my bio. It was Bev, my partner, whose encouragement and love and support got me to be involved in this. And bolstered by her friendship, I was encouraged to do it. And I got all the way into the semifinal round, and at the end of the semifinal round, playing one of my pieces, I ended up screwing up majorly, virtually guaranteeing that I wouldn't be selected to go into the final round. And in a way, that was fine with me. And I said, you know what, that's okay. And I was emboldened to try this again in 2003. Here is the program for 2003 as well. That's really the beginning of my story. Because in 2003, you might be able to tell, you can't see anything on these slides, unfortunately, but in 2003, I had three pieces in my preliminary round. And I got up to play, and I wasn't able to finish any of them. I started to play a piece, I lost my way, I couldn't finish, I went to the second piece, I lost my way, I couldn't finish. I went to the third piece, I lost my way, I couldn't finish. And I just ran off the stage in a feeling of utter humiliation. A nightmarish experience. I wouldn't recommend it for anybody, but it's the kind of thing that we all who perform worry is going to happen, and it's terrible when it actually manifests. It took me about 13 years to recover from that incident, although the recovery happened in stages, and I want to talk with you today about what happened and how I got to where I am today. So, a good deal of it has to do with this organization. Despite feeling utterly humiliated and embarrassed, I ended up still showing up to the annual meeting of the Boston Piano Amateurs in November of 2003, and I pushed past my feelings to join the organization. I knew that in joining the organization, that we were hosting meetings every month to play, and that I was going to have to do that in order to be able to get over this. I also became the treasurer, and in that way I made a kind of a real formal bond with the organization. Once I take on a task like that, you know, I'm going to do it, and so it really kind of committed me to participate. And I knew that way also that I wasn't going to participate in any of the Boston competitions, because you can't do that if you're the treasurer. We understand. I don't have to go into that too much. But Bev can attest to how anxious I used to get before any of the soirees. When I was going, I was freaking out. And when I would play, sometimes I hoped I would be able to get through it. It's a difficult time. But it leads to one of the things that I think is the most important thing. This is a statement by Nelson Mandela, and there are many that are like it. I like this one. It says, "I learned that courage was not the absence of fear, but the triumph over it. The brave man is not he who does not feel afraid, but he who conquers that fear." Many of my patients have this mistaken idea that when I get their anxiety to be a little better, because they're going to feel less anxious, they then can move toward doing something that's more brave. But I think that we get that wrong. I think we have to learn how to ignore the feeling of fear and just push forward. But part of the way in which we do that is by creating a new relationship with failure, or with perceived failure. And I'll talk about that at some length a little later on. Here's another one of my favorite quotes. It's not how far you fall, but how high you bounce that counts, right? And it's important to keep that. That's a Zig Ziglar, one of these motivational speakers. It's one of his comments. It's not how far you fall, but how high you bounce. It's important to keep that idea in mind. One of the things that I tell my patients these days is that when they are faced with some terrible event from their past that I always experience as analogous to my humiliation in 2003, I imagine them to think that there is a story arc that begins at that point, and that they haven't seen the end of that story arc yet. They're somewhere in the middle. And the retrospective view from when they get to a place that's better is going to make that early trauma much easier to bear. There's another story that I really love that I share a lot. I was a kid in Hebrew school when I first learned it. It's by supposedly a Jewish tale from the 1700s by the Magid of Dubno. And it goes like this. This king has this beautiful diamond, just extraordinary. It's his greatest possession. And he would take it out and would admire it all the time. And then one day he dropped it. And it got a really bad scratch on one of its faces. And he showed it to all of his jewelers in his kingdom to look at, and they all shook their head that it couldn't be buffed out because the diamond would crack and there wasn't anything they could do about it. And he became despondent. And then one jeweler from a surrounding kingdom heard about the king's plight and decided to come and address the king's problem. And he came by and he said, "King, I can do something for you." And the king, now not knowing what else to do, gave it to the jeweler to take care of it. And he said, "I'm going to need privacy for 2 weeks, and then I'll show you, and then you can see it." So he took the thing, and he started doing something with it. And when he showed it to the king, he brought it back, the king opened it up, and what he saw was that the scratch was still there, but the guy had used it to become the stem of a beautiful rose. And so what had happened was this traumatic event that had become so difficult for the king got made into something beautiful. It's a story that I think we all need to hear. We tend to look at the failures in our lives as these experiences that scratch us and will never change, but there's a way to take it and make it something beautiful. I'm sort of hoping I'm doing that with this experience of sharing with you my humiliation and difficulty from 2003 and what ended up happening to me. One of the things that I started to do to get better from my failings was I started to make YouTube videos at home. One of my major problems was, in 2003, is I didn't get through my pieces. So now, by making some YouTube videos and posting them, I proved to myself, to the world, that I can actually get through a piece. And so I've collected these. It's a good idea to do. It also gives you an opportunity to really look and listen to how you play. And that becomes an important piece later on. I think there's something else I wanted to say about this. I know, yeah, I forgot that part.
Well, also recording yourself, I think, puts you in that same mode of being in front of people. It's almost like a practice run before.
Yes, it is, and that's really valuable. But I wanted to share with you just how low I had gotten, that I was at a gathering of friends once, and I posted a bunch of YouTube videos, and they said, "Oh, I hear you play," and I pulled out my iPad so I could show them a YouTube video. I was seated right next to a 7-foot beautiful grand piano, and I'm pulling out this iPad to show them to you because I was too scared to perform in public, you know? But it was a start. But it wasn't enough of a start. I felt like I had to do something else. And so Boston is rich with educational opportunities. And one of the important educational opportunities It's for continuing education for those of us who are long past the age where we're in conservatories or in colleges. We have at the New England Conservatory a piano interpretation and performance seminar. And in 2011, I auditioned to be in that class. Remember, my big failing was in 2003, and I had just been playing and maybe making some YouTube videos, and this time I decided to do that. And I'll tell you, that's another one of those moments in which it took a lot of courage, because I knew that if I joined this class, I was going to have to perform every end of semester in an end of semester recital. And Bev can tell you, I always say to her, before these recitals, I promise I'm going to be good to you, even if I really screw up. Because, you know, I was a bear of a person to be with after the 2003 event. So I did this, but I knew at some level that this solution for me wasn't going to be until I got back on a competition stage, because that was where the real failing happened. And so the arc of my story, which began in 2003, would have to end at some point with a competition. And so 8 semesters into this piano interpretation performance seminar, the perfect opportunity came up. It was a competition in San Diego. And San Diego was like a second home for us, because my mother lived there. And it turns out that the competition weekend coincided with the weekend that we were going to be there for her 94th birthday celebration. So putting all these together, it felt like the perfect opportunity. And there was something else that was developing too. There was this story that many of you know, because you've been around me for long enough, about this man named Lajos Dele, who was my mother's sweetheart before she went to concentration camp and he was taken away and died in the Buchenwald concentration camp. And so I had already gotten some music from Dele's family, and I thought this would be a perfect opportunity to play the music in a place where my mother was going to be seated in the audience and she could hear the music from her sweetheart from before. So that's what happened, and I'm sure that, I don't know if anybody in this audience doesn't already know that I won first prize at that competition. And as far as I'm concerned, as a psychiatrist, this would have been the best outcome that I could have hoped for any patient at all. Given the arc of this story went from failure on a Boston stage in 2003 to triumph on a stage in San Diego in 2016. And I can now retrospectively look back from this position of having had this success on that earlier failure and look at it differently. And if I speak about it easily right now, I just want you to know that for the last, for the 10 years between 2003 and 2013, it wasn't at all easy for me to speak about what happened to me at that competition. And that's, I need you all, or I'm hoping that all of you will understand that it's very valuable to be able to imagine that someday you'll get to this new place whereby you can imagine the thing that really bothers you now from a very different perspective. And in fact, try to imagine what it looks like, what it would take to be at the end of that story arc in order for you to feel better about what happened earlier. And that's part of what I think is necessary. So, now that I've told you my story, I'm going to tell you how I did it, or at least how I think I did it, because when it's an evolving system. So I call it music to the rescue and also self-persuasion.